What I want to do today is there's two messages I thought of giving. I couldn't decide which one, but then what I thought I'd do, I'd combine them both, and actually it's going to work. I'm surprised myself that it worked so well, and hopefully you guys will be the judge in the third service. You all get up and walk out. I know it didn't go well this service. Anyway, a number of years ago, I did a talk with you about what we call 10 Principles for Successful Christian Living. And if you weren't there, the basis of the talk was this. It was back 40 years ago, 1977. I was doing a thing in East Troy, Wisconsin. It's kind of between Chicago and Milwaukee. It's a high school retreat for about 400 or 500 high schoolers from Chicago area. And it was a tremendous retreat. And the last talk, you know, the camp counselor, the camp director actually said, look, this has been a great week. But now the last talk, we're looking for something great. This has got to be your best talk because the kids really love it. Send them away with something good. The problem was I was fairly new at speaking at that time. I didn't have anything else to say. I'd said it all. I've been speaking all week. And so I prayed and asked the Lord to give me a talk, and he did, the 10 Principles for Successful Christian Living. And I've probably given it over 1,000 times in the last 40 years based on, you know, the not only the response but how helpful it's been to me and how helpful it's been to others. The first point of that is one of the two points I want to emphasize today, which I mean this in the bottom of my heart. I say if you really want to live a successful Christian life in God's eyes, I think 80% of your problems will be solved if you do, number one, get a biblical view of God. Get a proper view of God. See God as the Bible portrays him. In other words, have that view of God that fits with what the Scripture says. See, we can only know and understand God as much as he reveals himself to us. And the only way you and I are going to get that biblical view of God is by reading the Bible and understand what it says about his attributes or characteristics. I'm in the midst of finishing a 5-book series on God. One of them is called What Everyone Needs to Know About God, which deals with his attributes, his characteristics, and what he's like. And literally, if you understand what he's like, it can be life-changing, and it should be for each and every one of us. Because what we're told in Scripture is basically that God has made us in his image after his likeness, and he's made us in such a way where we can have that relationship with him. But when it comes to his characteristics, there's two types of them, and we have to understand this. First of all, there's characteristics that are unique to God alone. For example, God's been around forever. He's the eternal God. He didn't have a beginning, won't have an end. Humans cannot comprehend something like that. In fact, every time someone asks a question about how God can be eternal, your head starts to explode, right? Because everything we see has a beginning, middle, and end. God is all-powerful. Well, we don't understand being all-powerful, do we? We're limited human beings. We don't have the power that God has, so that's something unique to him. He's also, the Bible says, everywhere present. Everywhere present in the universe, God's there. And so we don't comprehend that. And also, he's all-knowing. He knows everything, past, present, and future, knows everything that has happened and knows everything that can happen or will happen. So this separates God from us. However, there's a bunch of characteristics that he has that are somewhat understandable by us because we share some of them in a certain way. Not exactly the same, but in a certain way. For example, we have attributes as human beings that God has. So to talk about that, I want you to turn in your Bible to the very first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 1. We're going to read about that as human beings were made in the image of God. The very famous verses, Genesis 1, 26 and 27. Genesis 1, 26 and 27. That should be an easy one to find. Should be the first book of your Bible, right? First chapter. Yeah. Sometimes some of these are hard to find. This one shouldn't be too difficult. All right. Anyway, God is speaking now, and he says, let us make humankind in our image, after our likeness, so they may rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the cattle and over all the earth and over all the creatures that move on the earth. God created humankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. All right, we've been created in the image and likeness of God, so that means in some ways, in some degrees, we reflect God and who we are as human beings. Well, okay, like what? Well, we can give love, we can receive love, we can be merciful, we can be patient, we can be righteous to a certain degree. In other words, we have these attributes that are similar to God's. Now, the problem is when we try and make them the same as God's. God's attributes are perfect, ours are imperfect, but at least we can understand in a certain way God. because we have characteristics that we share with him. He made us distinct from all other creatures, and that we have these attributes that are similar to him. Now, what's interesting about this, we need to study these attributes so we can know what he is like. Instead of creating God in our image, we need to understand he created us in his image. And to find out what he's like, we go to his word that tells us that. Now, something else, too. We need to understand what he's like because according to Ephesians 5:1, we are commanded to be imitators of God as his beloved children. We're to imitate God. Well, we need to know who he is, right, to imitate him properly. And so this is the command for believers to imitate God. So, summing up, he has characteristics that are unique to him alone, you know, eternal, all-powerful, all-knowing, everywhere present. But then he has characteristics that we share to some degree, love, personality, you know, mercy, justice, etc. All right, so in looking at these, I thought, okay, what am I going to do here? I had actually two different messages I thought of giving this morning, and what I've done, I've kind of put them both together, did half of each one, because, and it sort of worked out the first two services, where it'll explain, first of all, as we understand who God is, one of his characteristics, then how we put that into play in our life, understanding who we are. So the characteristic that I decided to take that I think is very important for us to understand is that God is omnipotent or all-powerful. He is all-powerful. He can do it. He can do it. In other words, if something needs to get done, God is able to do it. Now, with that in mind, there is a verse I want you to turn to, and I want you, when you get there, to, if you have something to mark in your Bible, to underline it in that. It's Psalm 78:41. Psalm 78:41. Turn to it, and this is a verse we all need to know, we all need to appreciate, and we all need to learn not to imitate. When I was a young student, young Christian, I was at Biola University. We had a speaker come, I believe it was in the year 1971-72, and this was the text of his verse. Now, I'm going to read out of the King James Version, and the reason is the word that's used in here, it's the only time it's used in the entire Old Testament. We're not really, there's a question on its exact meaning, but this seems to be one of the best, if not the best, meaning of it. But listen to this, from King James, Psalm 78:41. It says, "Yea, they turned back and tested God," here's the key, "and limited the Holy One of Israel." The people actually limited the Holy One of Israel. In the 1917 edition of the Jewish Publication Society, Hebrew Scriptures, here's how they translate this. "And still again they tried God and set bounds to the Holy One of Israel." Now some translations may say grieved, pain, pushed him to the limit, etc. But one of the ideas is, and this seems to be the main idea of this verse, in the Old Testament, when the children of Israel were wandering in the wilderness, they limited God's ability to work with them through unbelief. And this is something, and the reason I want you to know this verse, is something we shall never want to do. Hopefully none of us are doing that, limiting God. But I guarantee you, many of us are doing that. We basically have created God in our image, so we think he can only do A, B, C, and D. However, if we read the scriptures and get the biblical view of God, like we said, we can see that we are limiting him and we are not allowing him to be God in our life. And so it's very important at the get-go, we don't limit God. God wants to do miraculous works in your life and my life. The only thing holding him back sometimes is us by not allowing him to work in the way he wants to. This was the problem with Israel. God forbid if it's the problem with us, right? We don't want to limit God in that particular way. So here's the question we ask at the beginning. How can we, each of us, not limit the work of God in our life? How can we live in such a way where we're not limiting his work in our life? Well, first of all, it's a key to understand what it means that God is omnipotent or all-powerful. In other words, he is the God who can do it. He is the God of all power. In Genesis 17:1, he appears to Abraham. Abraham's 99 years of age. Still hadn't had the child of promise, and God said, and God comes to him. And in Hebrew, he says, "Ani El Shaddai, I am God Almighty." In other words, Abraham, guess what? The promise is going to be fulfilled in my time. I'm going to show you that you're going to have a child, you and Sarah, even though you're beyond the childbearing years, because I am God Almighty. So in the very first verses of the Bible, first book of the Bible, we see God himself making this claim that he is the Almighty God. All right, now, this is a theme that runs throughout Scriptures, and actually, we see it at the very end of the Bible, too. You don't have to turn here. Revelation 19:6, it's going to sound very familiar. We read this, "And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, as the sound of many waters, and as the sound of a mighty thundering, saying, Hallelujah, for the Lord God omnipotent reigns." Got to make a song out of that, shouldn't they? Anyway, I should say hallelujah for that. Anyway, Revelation 19:6, you've got the same thing being taught, that God is omnipotent. He is all-powerful. He appeared to Abraham as the all-powerful God and showed him miraculously that he could have a child, he and his wife, even though physically they were beyond the childbearing years. And so from the first book of the Bible to the last, one of the themes is that the God of Scripture is all-powerful. He can do it. So if we're going to get a proper biblical view of God, this is one characteristic you and I really need to understand, that he is El Shaddai, that he is God Almighty. Now, when we look and see what the Scripture has to say about this, there's a few things that we need to understand and to qualify this. All right, first of all, God is free to do whatever he pleases. No one can tell him what to do. No one is his counselor. No one is his judge. No one can force God to do anything or tell him he cannot do anything. This is important for us to know, because if God sets out to do something, he'll do it. Remember in Matthew 16 when Jesus is talking about there in Caesarea Philippi, he asks the question, who do people say that I am? And Peter says, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. And basically Jesus says, blessed are you, Simon, son of John, for saying this. And he said this, I'm going to build my church, and the gates of Hades are going to prevent it. In other words, I'm going to do my plan, and nothing in the world will stop it. You know, to me, that's one of the greatest miracles we see, the greatest miracles of all time. Because if you look at the history of the Christian church, by all odds, it should have disappeared long ago, because it's made up of fallible human beings fighting with each other, this and that. Yet here we are in the 21st century, still here, still proclaiming the word of God, just as Jesus predicted. So nothing is going to stop it. So basically, if God is going to do something, not only in the world, let's personalize it, in your life and my life, nobody's going to stop it. No human being can. Now, I don't know about you, but I've had people in my life, and actually some of them are still there, that kind of want to thwart the plan of God in my life. Have you met people like that? Okay, good. We're on the same page, right? That they don't like you and I following Jesus, right? They don't like us serving Christ. So they're going to try and get us off the straight and narrow here. Well, Jesus said, ain't going to happen. He's going to build the church and nothing's going to stop it. Now, not only that, he is powerful enough to do anything. All things are possible for him. This is important for us to understand. All things are possible for him that are consistent with his character. Y'all, and I don't know if you ever heard this before. Probably someone will say, can your God do anything? Yeah. Well, can he make a rock so big he can't lift? Can he create a being that can destroy him? Can he make a four-sided triangle? Well, no, God doesn't do stupid things. He can't do things inconsistent with his holy character. So there are things that God can't do. In fact, Titus 1:2 says, God can't lie. He's not able to lie. So knowing that, when we understand his power, it's always within a consistency of who he is, okay? In other words, there's a limitation to it, self-imposed limitation. And so we can understand who he is. He is all-powerful, but only to do that which is right and that which is consistent with his character. Now, no things are impossible for him. Genesis 18:14, the Lord says, I am the Lord. Is anything too difficult for me? And the answer, of course, is no, not at all. Jeremiah 32:27, you got the same thing. I am the Lord, the God of all humanity. Is anything too hard for me? And the answer is no. God can do anything he wishes to do. And so we see this happen over and over again. Probably one of the greatest examples of that, the one we remember the most as we're getting towards Easter time, is there with the Annunciation in Luke's Gospel, where the angel Gabriel comes to the Virgin Mary and says, you're going to conceive a son, and you'll call his name Jesus, and he will rule over the house of his father David, and the house of David for years and years, and of his kingdom there will be no end. And Mary says, how can this be? I've never known a man sexually. I don't know. This is not possible. And the angel says, for with God, nothing is impossible, right? Nothing is impossible as far as God's concerned. God can do it. And this is something we need to understand. We need to allow him to be God. We don't want to limit him. We want to understand that if he wants to do something, he is certainly capable and willing to do it, and he will do it. And that's what's promised in Scripture. For nothing is impossible with God, Luke 1:37. And of course, the promise came true. The virgin conception, the Lord Jesus, was born. So, our God, when he wants to do something, he's going to get the job done. Now, furthermore, his purpose, like we said, cannot be stopped. No one can stop it. In Job 42:2, it's interesting what Job says. I know that you can do all things. No plan of yours can be thwarted. And that's a pretty good verse. Let me read that again. I know that you can do all things. No plan of yours can be thwarted. Again, if God has a plan for your life, if God's got a course for you and you're following him and he set you on that course, it's not going to be stopped. It's not going to be thwarted. I don't care who tries to get in the way. I don't care what they try to do. He is not going to let it be thwarted. I can personally testify over the years, I've had a few people that tried to thwart the plan of God in my life. And it was interesting watching the Lord work, and a couple of them actually disappeared from the face of the earth, you know. And I didn't ask God to do that, but I thought, wow, this is, you know, this is kind of heavy stuff. But yeah, and so, you know, if God's got his hand on you, and he does, and he's got a plan, and people try to get in the way, you gotta watch out, because the Lord doesn't like that sort of stuff, and nothing, he's not going to let anything stop it in his purpose. Now, what's really interesting, I love this next illustration. Remember King Nebuchadnezzar? Nebuchadnezzar was the head of gold, according to Daniel's prophecy. He was the king of the great Babylonian Empire. Four great kingdoms coming to the earth. Nebuchadnezzar was the first king. He was the head of gold, the king of kings. His rule was, you know, further than anyone else's. And he's the one given that image there in Daniel chapter 2. Then, of course, in Daniel chapter 3, Nebuchadnezzar thinks, wait a minute, I'm more than the head of gold. I'm going to build a whole image of gold. I'm going to be everything. And then in Daniel chapter 4, Nebuchadnezzar learns how there's, you know, blessed, how are the mighty humbled, right? You know what's interesting, what I found out too? You think of this Nebuchadnezzar as this great, awesome figure, right? He's this great king of Babylon. Actually, there's some evidence that Nebuchadnezzar is only like about 4'10" tall. Yeah, he's this little short guy. And yet he's like Napoleon, I guess. He thinks he's the head of gold and the whole body of gold. Anyway, when it gets to Daniel chapter 4, if you recall, Nebuchadnezzar is looking out at all his kingdom, how great it is and that, and how, you know, he's the head of gold, this and that. And then the Lord allows him for a season, basically to live like an animal, feed off the grass of the field, this and that. And when he comes to his senses, listen to what Nebuchadnezzar says. This is from the pagan king of Babylon. All the peoples of the earth are regarded as nothing. He does as he pleases with the powers of heaven and the people of the earth. No one can hold back his hand or say to him, what have you done? That's Daniel 4:35. Nebuchadnezzar learned that. When God wants to do something, nobody can stop what he wants to do. Now, in doing so, let's understand something else. God is not like us. He's going to perform his plan. He's going to do it, but he doesn't get tired in doing it. One of the things that we often make the mistake of doing is thinking, well, you know, God's probably tired of hearing from me the same confession, the same prayer, this and that. No, no, he wants you to come to him. He wants to hear it over and over again, what's on your mind. He's the everlasting God. He does not faint or grow weary, Isaiah 40:28 says. So God's not going to get tired of us. Thankfully, you know, we get tired of ourselves and tired of each other, but God doesn't get tired of us. He doesn't grow weary of his everlasting love. And in Psalm 121:4, it says he never sleeps or slumbers. So the Lord's always there. Now, this ought to clear up the misconception that so many people have. In other words, I want to talk to God, but I got to come through the doors of a church or come to some building that has stained glass or some holy ground. Now, God is there wherever we need him to be. Like if you're driving through Taco Bell and you fall asleep, you know, there are three different times the Lord is there. And thank God Tom had the presence of mind to put it in park every time he was waiting. But no, but God was with him. I mean, I've been jet lagged before, and I've forgotten things like that too. And by the grace of God, God's with us, right? And so he doesn't faint or grow weary, even though we do, after not getting that much sleep. Now, we see God's omnipotence, his power everywhere. And one of the things I'm afraid none of us really appreciate to the degree we should is his omnipotence is all-powerfulness in creation. I mean, we take for granted, don't we, the creation around us? But you ever look into it, how precise everything is in this world? I mean, the ecosystem that God has created. Because as far as we know, as far as we can tell, whether we look geographic, whether we look telescopically or microscopically, we see design. We see the hand of a loving, caring designer who has perfected things. Even though we live in a fallen world, what do we see? We see God's, you know, unique design in all this. The simple cell is not a simple cell, as we were taught, many of us as kids. The simple cell, the single cell, is very complicated because God is the designer with very unique design. And so we miss that by looking around. We take for granted. I like to use this example. It was in a number of years ago, my mother and I'd taken on a vacation to Europe, and we're there in Frankfurt, Germany. We're flying, we're on the airport on the tarmac, okay? And the pilot gets on, and he says, you know, we're going to take off in a few minutes. We will be at the gate in Baltimore at 8:34. Now, here we are in Frankfurt, Germany. We're going to fly overseas. We're going to be at the gate in 8:34. Well, guess what? At 8:34, we are parked at the gate. How can you be so precise? Because of the universe God has made, because of knowing exactly, living in a universe that's functional, that's ordered, that's well-ordered. And so we see his omnipotence everywhere in creation. Creation that came about by his spoken word. God said, let it be, and it was. Okay, so here's the thing. The first point is this, that God himself has revealed to us what he is like. He is the all-powerful God. He can do anything consistent with his character. He is the God who created and spoke the world into existence. And he is the God who is controlling the universe also. We talked about this, if you were with us last Sunday night, about prophecy, where the God of the Bible compares himself to the gods of the ancient world. And he says, okay, false gods, tell us what you've done in the past. Show us your record. Set forth your case. Give us evidence where you predicted the future. And I think this is humorous because the gods, you know, these idols just sit there not saying anything. Oh, God's, okay, well, I'll interrogate you some more. Well, how about predicting something that's going to happen in the future? Tell us what's going to happen so we can be afraid of you. The idol just sits there not saying anything, you know. And then the Lord eventually says, those that worship you are fools. They're foolish. They're, you know, it's ridiculous because you don't exist. There's no substance there. Well, God has told us past, present, and future because he knows all things. And he's all-powerful where he's in control of all things. So, first and foremost, let's understand that's who our God is, okay? So let's check that one off. We don't want to limit him. Psalm 78:41. If you have to print that out in the King Jimmy version or put it on your refrigerator or whatever it might be, see there. We don't want to limit the Holy One of Israel. Now, having said that, what do we do in light of that? What is our responsibility? And this comes to the other talk I was thinking about giving you. So what I'm going to do, like I said, is take half of this first one and half of the second one. As some of you know, every Wednesday night for the last couple of years, I've been team teaching with Pastor Barry at Calvary Tustin. And we're doing now the book of Hebrews. We did Revelation before. We're doing Hebrews now. And I did chapter 12, the first few verses this last week. And man, that just really, I mean, my eyes were open in ways that never had before in a long time. Chapter 12 of Hebrews basically starts with this word, therefore. Now, as always, when you see therefore, you want to know what's the therefore. Therefore, chapter 11, of course, is the great hall of faith, all the believers, you know, down through the ages, Abraham, Moses, you know, the people who trusted God by faith. And what the author is doing, he's showing his readers that you're now on you know, you're in a great long line of people who have trusted God. And you now are to finish the course that they started, to finish the race, as it were. What's interesting about this is that the very first word there, what's the second line, but the word that's used there in Hebrews chapter 12, the word translated therefore, is not just one word for therefore. It's actually three different conjunctions that all use the word, we all mean therefore. In other words, you can say therefore in different ways. There's three different ways you can say it. What the author does is put these three words together. Now, remembering the fact that the scriptures were read out loud at the beginning, that would be an attention getter. Because if I said, therefore, 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 you go, well, I think he's trying to be emphatic, right, by saying it, but they're saying it three different ways. Now, it's interesting because I shared this with my daughter, who, like I said, who was with us this last week, and she's, you know, majors in classical languages, Latin and Greek there at Duke, and she, in fact, she's reading Homer. Homer, you know, when we were, she's so far above me, it's not even funny, this last week. And I showed that to her, and she said, well, Dad, don't forget something else. The Greek language of old was a language where there was emphasis, there was pitch there, almost like a musical. And so she said, when the people would hear this, that last syllable, they would come up and go down on it, which would really get their attention. She gave me an illustration of what it would sound like. I said, yeah, so not only would it hit someone to have the same word say in three different ways, but also the way it came down, they would all be leaning forward to hear that. And basically, the author says this, therefore, since we are encompassed or circled by such a great cloud of witnesses, then he says, let us do this. Let us put aside every weight and every sin and every sin that easily besets us. Let's lay aside every weight. And we look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, is now set down at the right hand of the throne of God. But the point is, okay, we're to look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. But in doing so, we're to lay aside every weight and the sin that easily is put before us. Now, what's fascinating about this, you've got another analogy with the ancient sports events, laying aside weight and running the race. And it talks about, it's almost like an ancient amphitheater where they had these tiered rows of seats, and the spectators are all leaning forward, and they're watching these people run the race. Well, in a sense, that's the analogy. That's what we're doing. But you've got Paul saying the same thing in 1 Corinthians 9:27, we run the race to win. And so the idea is here, we're running a race in life. And to run it to win, we're to lay aside everything that would hinder us from running to win. And so the idea is, whatever weight it might be, we don't want to carry it with us. Now, immediately we think of weight and of sin. The sin that easily besets us, the sin that weighs us down, the sin that keeps us from running, running to win. Well, that's obvious. But also, too, we're to lay aside anything that would keep us from winning the race. And there was an interesting comment I read, and it's only one place, one of the ancient commentators, Albert Barnes, on several hundred years old, and he mentioned this. He said, you know, it's not only the sins that, you know, weigh us down. Sometimes it's things that aren't bad in and of themselves that keep us from running the race the way we should. And he gave a really interesting illustration in Mark's gospel of the blind man Bartimaeus. Bartimaeus was a man who was blind who wanted Jesus to heal him, and they called him over to see Jesus. And it said when he heard this, he threw off his robe and ran as fast as he could to see Jesus. Now, nothing wrong with the robe, but the robe was an impediment for him to run as fast as he can. And I'm thinking, wow. And what the writer said, you know, there are things now that aren't wrong in and of themselves, but sometimes we need to get rid of them because they're hindering our walk with the Lord or hindering us winning the race. Now, with respect to the sins, we all have to fill in the blank there, what it is. Whatever's hindering you, and you got to fill in your own blank, we're all different, of keeping you, what weight is keeping you back from running that race properly. There may be not any obvious sin, but maybe it's something that's really not bad in and of itself, but something you need to throw off, something that's taking your attention away from the gospel, taking your attention away from serving the Lord. And again, you need to examine yourselves and fill in the blank personally to what this might be. Because I guarantee you, if we start thinking about it for a while, thinking, you know, I'm doing this, and I should really be spending that much time doing this? I mean, is this really what God wants me to do? And it's a good question to ask ourselves. Now, we need to have a balance here, of course, but the interesting thing is the example I like to share with you from the late Pastor Chuck Smith. Pastor Chuck, many of you know, I had the privilege of doing a radio program with him, first called To Every Man an Answer, then Pastor's Perspective, for a lot of years. And I've never met a person in my life who was so one-track mind for the Lord. It's all he ever wanted to talk about, the things of God. It's all he could ever live for, and particularly the last year of his life as he gets into the studio when he knows he's about to die. Never once complained, never once showed any sign of weakness, never once, you know, asked for sympathy. Everybody asks him how he's doing. I'm doing great. When we know he knows he's dying. He knows he's got, you know, a certain number of days. He's not going to show that. But all I could think of was serving the Lord, you know, and serving the Lord. In fact, it was the, I remember I was watching, and it was really difficult to watch. I was speaking somewhere, and it was his last Sunday that he did, last one he ever did. And I'd known that a couple of days before, the doctor had told him, there's no hope, you only got a couple weeks to live. And he came out, and the first thing he said was, "One more time, one more time." And that was it, the last time he spoke. And I've never met anybody like that. I have a good friend, Dave Sweet. He's the pastor at Calvary Chapel up in Northern California, the city of Paradise. He's known Chuck for many, many years. In fact, Chuck married him and his wife in 1965, him and Betty. And, you know, and so Dave knew Chuck way before he became known, way before anybody knew him from Adam. And I said, "Let me ask you something, Dave. What was Chuck like in 1965? And Dave always calls me Donald. He says, "Donald, he was the same then as he has now. All he could think about was Jesus." And I thought, isn't that a great testimony? Because that's the testimony of someone that knew him. All he could think about was Jesus. And that's what we should be doing. And if we're going to do that, there's certain things that we need to lay aside to go on the straight and the narrow. Now, here's part of the problem that we find as we're doing this. We had a call, was it last week or the week before, I think it was, that, you know, many of you know, if you don't, I do a radio program. It's on 4 days a week, Pastor's Perspective 107.9 at the end of the FM dial. For 3 to 4, we answer live questions from live people who call in with their own issues. We had a question a week ago or so that really, really irritated me. Usually I don't get irritated with the questions. In fact, hardly ever. But this one really got to me. The guy calls in and he says, "I heard a pastor talk about sins. And he talked about major sins and minor sins. Would you please tell me what are major sins and what are minor sins?" And I thought, okay, well, I said, let me answer it this way. The Bible says all unrighteousness is sin. If you've sinned in one point, you've sinned in all the points, James says. You know, in other words, you've broken one point of the law, you've sinned all of that. Sin is any type of rebellion against God. Well, obviously, there are different consequences for some sins, different consequences if you're angry with someone versus murdering them. But in God's eyes, it's all wrong. All right, and so we got this question, and then all of a sudden, we see on the screen, we got a screen. The call screener saying, "We got a number of people calling. Want you to elaborate on that, or what's a big? They want to know what a big sin is, a little sin." And I felt like saying, "Why? Why would you want to know? Are you trying to ask me what I can get away with? In other words, you know, if this is only a little sin, maybe I can do it. Maybe I can get away with it. You know, so please give me the list so I can check off what's okay." And actually, I had that question a number of years ago. I really did. I was out doing an outdoor thing one summer, and the question came up was this: how far can I go, you know, literally to the edge and still be a Christian? In other words, how much sin can I get away with before God's going to, you know, give me the heave-ho? And I'm thinking, boy, is that ever the wrong question? If someone asks that question, I really wonder if they know the Lord, because they're asking, you know, what can I get away with? So I was thinking, these callers, as best as I can tell, are trying to ask me, okay, tell me what's really bad, but tell me what's not so bad. And no, that's not the question you want to ask. It's all bad. None of it's good. Sin is not good, whether it's small or large. And I'm not going to tell you, I'm not going to make a distinction between the two. A number of years ago, excuse me, I was doing Sunday morning with you guys, and I gave this message, and I told an illustration that happened to me. I'm going to tell it again because it speaks to this point. We're moving back from Midwest back to California, and I was driving by myself, and I'd stopped out in El Centro for the night. And before I took off, you know, I had a deadline. I know a couple good churches out there, but I just didn't have time. But I thought, you know, I want to watch something on TV before, at least, you know, Sunday morning before I go. And I turned on Charles Stanley, and he gave a message that, again, really got me, hit me between the eyes. I'm so glad I turned him on, because he was talking about sin. He was talking about, you know, sins that we do and sins that we don't do, and about obedience and disobedience. And here's what he said. Here was the punchline. He said, "Partial obedience is disobedience. Partial obedience is disobedience." In other words, it's almost like these people were calling in asking, "Well, you know, if I'm 95% doing what God wants, that's okay, isn't it?" No, no. if we are only partially obeying the Lord, we're disobeying. If we know what to do and we're not doing it, that is sin, and that is not pleasing to God. And so the last thing we want to do is ask for some list of what we can get away with so it's all right, or keep our own little sins. Now again, as we lay aside these weights, and again, you're running the race. Remember, you've got the finish line there ahead of you, and the finish line, of course, is eternity. You're laying aside the weight because you want to run, not to just finish, but to run to win. We have to realize that there are things weighing us down. But this is something unique for each and every one of us. In other words, your sin over here, your weight over here might not be the weight of this person over there. We all have got them, and we all need to look ourselves in the mirror and be intellectually honest about it. What do I need to get rid of as I'm trying to run the race, not only to finish, but to win? And are there things like blind Bartimaeus, like his robe, that what's keeping him from getting to Jesus faster? Well, if there is, then we need to get rid of that. You see, the Lord wants us. He wants us to honor him. He wants us to know him. And he wants others, people, when they see us, to think of him. It would be nice sometimes, or maybe it wouldn't be, if we really would ask people to honestly, objectively, what do they think of us? What do they see us? What do they think? I had a professor in Bible college who gave me the greatest illustration. He says, when people see you coming down the street, what is the first thing that comes into their mind? He said, it should be this. Oh, that's so-and-so. They're a Jesus man or Jesus woman. All they think about is Jesus. To some people, it's not this. It's no, they're so-and-so. They're against this. They're against that. They stand against this. They hate this. Well, okay, if we're Christians, there are going to be certain things we're against, right? Certain things we don't like. But that should never be the thrust of your life. The thrust of your life is what you're for. You're a pro-Jesus person. You're going to be anti-certain things. Of course we are. But let your testimony be first and foremost what you're for, who you're for, and that's the Lord Jesus. My youngest daughter at this Christmas gave me a wonderful Christmas present. It was, in fact, the nicest one I've ever got. I've told her that. She got a shirt made for me. In fact, she cleared it with my oldest daughter to make sure everything was spelled right. But the shirt says, Servant of Jesus Christ. That's what she got me for Christmas. And I'm thinking, oh, I hope that's how my daughter sees me. I really do, because that's what I'm trying to be. And I hope that's how other people see me. And I hope that's how people see you. That's who we should be seeing, as a servant of Jesus Christ. But to do that, what do we got to do? We got to keep laying aside the weight. So if something comes in your mind and your purview, and you say, you know, I know this one. You know, if it's wrong, you know what's wrong. That's not an issue. But if there's some things saying, you know, is this really the smartest thing for me to do? Maybe it's good to lay aside that weight, just like Bartimaeus did as he walked the straight and narrow, actually ran the straight and narrow to get to Jesus as fast as possible. So with all that saying, here's the bottom line. There's two things that we want to emphasize today. Number one, who God is. Number two, what's our responsibility in following him, to be imitators of him. Again, Ephesians 5:1. How do we know who God is? We don't create him in our image. We go to the scripture. We find out what the scripture says about God, who he is, what he's like, what he can do, what he doesn't do, and we follow that. Once we get in our minds he is able to do anything consistent with his character, then we don't want to be like Israel of the Old Testament, like Psalm 78:41. We don't want to limit him. We want to be everything he has us to be. Nothing more, nothing less, right? We really want him to work in our lives supernaturally. Once we understand that, then we say, okay, what's my responsibility in all this? Once I have the right view of God, what am I supposed to do? And as the writer of the Hebrews says in chapter 12, well, you're going to look to Jesus because he's already run the course ahead of you. 1 John 2:6 says you're to walk or conduct your life as he did, but in doing so, you're to get rid of any impediments, any weight that's keeping you from being that person. And you have to ask yourself, what are they and how can I get rid of them? And then do it and keep your eye on the prize. Keep your eye on the goal. So that's what God has for us today. As we're living the life, as we're trying to serve the Lord and through the power of the Holy Spirit in the best way possible, there's two things we really need to know. We really need to know who he is. And we're only going to know that reading the scripture. But number two, we need to know who we are and where we fall short. We all do. There's always something we can improve on, all of us. And if once we understand that, we need to work on that. Say, Lord, help me by your grace get rid of this thing or take this thing out of my life. Now, I mentioned the second service. Say, oh, great, I'm going to pray that God I'll get rid of my boss. No, we're not talking about that. Maybe you should. But no, this is something in our lives, okay? Not, if I only have this boss gone, I'll be fine. No. Because look, like we get calls all the time, I'm the only Christian, I have a bunch of pagans around me. Well, praise God, you're the light in the darkness. That's what you're there for, you know? And to shine, and because, you know, who knows? We'll be, today's unbelievers, tomorrow's Christian. You don't know who they're going to be. But the point is, things in our own personal life, what we need to get rid of so we can walk that straight and narrow, so we can hear someday from the Lord when we stand in his presence, well done, good and faithful servant. But how are we going to be able to do that? The only way you and I are going to be able to do this is, number one, know who God is, have a biblical view of God, know his attributes, know his characteristics, know what he does do, what he doesn't do, and understand what God has said about himself in Scripture. Then number two, look yourself in the mirror. 2 Corinthians 13:5 says, examine yourself to see if you're in the faith. Check yourself out and say, all right, I'm going to go down the list. What am I doing, or what that I shouldn't be doing, or what should I be doing that I'm not doing, where I can honor him? 1 Samuel 2:30 says, those that honor him, he will honor. So today, that's the challenge. First of all, to know God, then to know yourself, know what's lacking, and then walk the straight and narrow. So someday you'll hear those words from the Lord. Well done, good and faithful servant.